Coming up on CU Sports Mag, we have some tennis action for you.
And lacrosse gets down and dirty, and it looks like they're scoring big.
And we also have a tribute to our executive producer, Russell Cunningham. Stay tuned. Hello and welcome to CU Sports Mag's very last show of the semester. I'm Kylie Burst, sitting alongside Sam Holt.
And up next, we've got some video with new head coach Boyle.
There's no question to me that Tad Boyle represents everything that's right about college basketball. The way he conducts himself, the way he does everything that he does associated with being a leader. His love of the game is really unparalleled. And I think that is awesome for us. And he cares deeply about players, fans, donors, alumni, faculty. He's got a heart of gold, and he's got a competitive spirit that really is second to none. It is with great pleasure, honor, and pride that I introduce the next head men's basketball coach for your team, the Colorado Buffaloes, Tad Boyle.
There will be nobody that has coached at the University of Colorado that is going to give you more of their heart and soul than I will, because this job means everything to me. This is a destination job for me. This is a dream job for me. Go Buffaloes. I'm going to try to make you proud.
Boyle's ties to Colorado and college hoops goes back further than you may think. He was the Colorado Player of the Year as a senior at Greeley Central High School in 1981. Then Boyle played under coach Larry Brown at Kansas from 82 to 85, making two tournament appearances and one trip to the Elite Eight. After serving as a coach for various programs in Colorado, Boyle joined the staff of current Texas A&M coach Mark Turgeon at Oregon, who he had played with in college. Boyle followed Turgeon to Tennessee and finally Wichita State, where he served as an assistant from 2000 to 2005. In April of 2006, Boyle returned home to become the 17th head coach of the Northern Colorado Bears, where he directed a jump from 4 to 25 wins in his 3 years in Greeley before bouncing to Boulder.
Less than a week into his new job as the Buffs head coach, Tad Boyle has made one of the best recruiting moves of the year. The move? Keeping freshman sensation Alec Burks on the roster. Burks is kind of a big deal. He averaged over 17 points per game and won Big 12 Freshman of the Year honors. Throughout his titanic freshman year, Burks became an all-time leading freshman scorer at the University of Colorado. Burks plans on heading to the NBA soon, and having to sit out a season after transferring would not have slowed down that process. The electric scorer will be one of the Coach Boyle's focal points for his upcoming season.
The CU Triathlon team took home a national championship last Saturday at the USAT Collegiate Nationals in Lubbock, Texas. Colorado's Cedric Wayne and Jessica Broderick each had second-place finishes. Wayne's supporting cast of six Buffs all scored in the top 25, earning first place for the men. The CU women earned second as a team, only 8 points behind first-place Army. The Buffs' combined total of 109 points gave them a decisive win for the overall team title, defeating second and third place Army and Navy by over 55 points each. The triathlon team returns to Boulder this week to begin training for the 2011 season, while leading Buff Jessica Broderick will race Collegiate Worlds in Italy this May.
CU Boulder's Emma Coburn continued to make track history when she ran 3,000 meters in a time of 9 minutes, 56.29 seconds, the fastest time in the world at the Mount SAC Relays this Thursday, April 15th. During the event, Coburn started off in fourth place but managed to pull herself into second for the final lap. In a dramatic finish, she passed her competitor in the last 300 meters to win the race. Coburn is now setting her sights on becoming an All-American top eight and later on the London 2012 Olympic Games. Coburn is now ranked number one in the nation and the world, and because of this, she has been named Big 12 and CU Sports Mag's Athlete of the Week.
And coming up after the break, we have David Starcer and John Michael Tomczak with info on basketball and football.
That's right, and we also have our fearless leader, Russell Cunningham. There he is now.
All right, and go ahead and roll green, red. Roll red, take it, and take it. Take it, take it, take it. Roll it, full sound. Thank you. Kill my audio, kill my audio, kill my audio, kill my...
welcome back. Up next, we have Double Team with John Michael Tomczak and David Starcer.
That's right. Take it away, guys.
Welcome to the Double Team set. I'm John Michael Tomczak here with my colleague, David Starcer. Here, we're going to start off by talking about the new kid on the CU coaching block, new men's basketball coach, Tad Boyle.
Tad Boyle, a guy who's been around the block, I guess, to use your expression, a time or two. Actually, has roots here in Colorado, played high school ball here in Colorado, was a Greeley native. Went and played some college ball for Larry Brown up at Kansas for a couple years. And then, hey, when he started his coaching, he came right back here to Colorado, coached at a couple high school programs before getting into the college ranks. And again, when he got his first head coaching job, it was here in Colorado in his hometown of Greeley. And to be honest, I like the move by AD Mike Bone with this move. I think Mike Bowles is going to definitely be a good hire.
It's a solid move, and it definitely should be a good hire. It was a low-risk hire, yeah. And it was the sensible hire, mm-hmm. rather than trying to get alumni funds together and say go after Gonzaga coach Mark Few.
Right.
But with CU's budget situation right now, that's an unrealistic option. Mm-hmm. And quite frankly, CU's made out well financially with the two latest hirings and firings of Kathy McConnell Willer and Jeff Bizdelic, as the new replacements Linda Lapp and Tad Boyle are making about 15% less than their predecessors, plus the $500,000 buyout that was due to the University of Colorado by Wake Forest, and University of Colorado only paid $25,000 to get Tad Boyle from UNC.
I definitely think it was a money conscious decision by Mike Bone to go with the hire on this one. But again, from a basketball standpoint, it's not that bad of a hire either. The thing that I'm most concerned about is the recruiting end of it for Tad Boyle. It's going to be interesting to see if he can go after and get some of the big men that Jeff Bizdelic was going after, guys like Majuk and guy Michelle Michael, some 7-footers that could really help, you know, the perimeter guys, the guys like Alec Burks and Corey Higgins. We got scorers on our team. We just need some big guys, some rebounding down low. So it'll be interesting to see what he can do with that. But like you said, he's coaching with guys like Mark Turgeon. He's had great success at UNC, going from 4 wins to 25 wins. I like where the program's going.
The big thing is that he knows the area. Mm-hmm. He's from Colorado, and that's kind of been a tendency of Colorado athletics lately.
Yeah.
Is not going back to Colorado roots. They let Matt Bolden escape to Gonzaga. They let Sean O'Gary escape to Wichita State. And these are big recruits from the state of Colorado that Colorado needs to get. And I think with the Tad Boyle administration or the era, that's going to start happening again here, and we're going to start seeing more Colorado recruits playing for the University of Colorado.
Yeah, definitely have my fingers crossed on that one. Like I said, hopefully things turn around in state-wise. Switching gears, looking at the NFL draft, it was last night. First night, it was over in prime time in New York City, and kind of the big story of the night, the big splash was made by none other than Josh McDaniels from the Denver Broncos. They made a couple of trades in the first round, traded down a few slots, but then ended up at the very end of the night trading back up to number 25 and taking none other than Florida quarterback Tim Tebow.
A controversial decision by Josh McDaniels, but it became evident throughout the night with all the trades that the man definitely has a plan.
Yeah.
And it's a matter of Bronco fans letting there be time to let the plan work out, whether it be 3 or 4 years, but it depends on the patience of Pat Bowlen, and Pat Bowlen has shown in the past that he's willing to give Josh McDaniels a lot of leeway, especially with the whole Jay Cutler saga.
Well, this whole kind of draft night thing was really interesting if you look at it. You know, McDaniels traded down a few slots in his first couple picks, traded from 11 down to 15, finally down to 25. And I think that was because the guys that he had his eye on, guys like Alabama linebacker Orlando McClain and Florida center Marquise Pouncey, were taken a couple slots before they were expected to. McClain got taken by our division rival, the Raiders. So I think he kind of just waited and see how the draft kind of went down and ended up kind of just going up and grabbing Tebow, a very good character guy. I don't know if there's a better character guy really than Tim Tebow out there. And if nothing else, this is just light a fire under the current quarterbacks on the roster, you know, Kyle Orton and Brady Quinn. I think it's going to be an open competition at quarterback when training camp rolls around in August.
And that's the big thing with McDaniels' system from New England. It's about creating competition, mm-hmm. and New England always traded down their picks when they didn't have the exact guy they wanted. They always traded down for multiple picks. They're cheaper and create competition in every position, and the best player who wants it more, who's coming in with a little edge, will get that position. And that's how that won them 3 Super Bowls and created one of the best dynasties in NFL history.
Now, the other first-round pick that McDaniels took for the Broncos was wideout from Georgia Tech, Demaryius Thomas. Obviously a talented guy. A little bit of a head-scratcher, though. I know some Broncos fans are wondering why we took a wideout from a system that runs a triple-option offense. But he's a very talented guy. Again, another great locker room guy. And in the end, I think that he took him over talented Oklahoma State wideout Dez Bryant simply because of that fact. He didn't want to roll the dice again with a guy like Dez Bryant, who had a lot of comparisons to Brandon Marshall, a guy that they recently got traded, just because of the off-the-field issues.
And I think running that triple, being a part of that triple option tech offense at Georgia Tech actually showed the type, actually showed the type of character he was, because he was originally recruited by Chan Gailey to run a pro-style offense.
Yeah.
And now he's the type of character guy. He never complained. And now thank you for joining us, David Starcer and John Michael Tomczak. And now we'll toss it back onto the set.
Thanks, guys. The competition at quarterback has been the norm for CU football the past few years and is likely to continue this year as well. Although Tyler Hansen is listed atop the depth chart at the end of spring practices, he still has not distanced himself from Cody Hawkins. Head coach Dan Hawkins recently said that the competition between the two is, quote, paper thin, and that there is not much difference between the two. Hawkins has started the past 3 years only to be replaced by Hansen at points in the past two seasons. Hansen took over for Hawkins in Game 5 last year and went 2-5 as a starter.
On Thursday, the NCAA approved three new changes to college football rules. Eye black with messages and wedge blocks will be banned from college football this season, and taunting on the field of play will start costing the team points in 2011. The wedge blocking change seemed to create the most buzz amongst college football world. Studies show that 20% of all injuries occurring on kickoffs result in concussions. The committee followed the NFL's lead by banning the wedge blocking scheme. Messages and symbols on eye black, which has seen growing popularity in recent years, seems to be a minor change in comparison to the others. The committee expects that more proposals to changes will surface in the future in hopes that they will have their approval in time for the 2011 season. College hoops enthusiasts can breathe easy. Speaking of changes, the NCAA tournament is expanding, but not to the 96 teams free-for-all many analysts feared. The tourney is expanding only to 68 teams, creating three more play-in games for the right to be destroyed by a one seed in the first round. The changes come on the heels of a new 14-year broadcast agreement the NCAA struck with CBS and TBS. Expect the next round of expansion talks to begin in 2024.
Last Saturday, the 9th-ranked CU Buffs took on number 10 Michigan State Spartans in a battle on Kittredge Field. James Blackburn starts it off for the Buffs by going down low to score the first point of the game for the Buffaloes. Junior Patrick Nemes was able to answer and slipped one by Buff goal Brad McNee. However, the Spartans were only able to muster four goals as the Buff defense played strong for the whole game. Captain Aaron Gray wins another faceoff, this one leading to another Blackburn goal. The Buffs dominated MSU, winning the game by a score of 10-4. With the victory, CU improved to 500 on the season at a record of 5-5.
For football fans and teams, the NFL draft is a crucial stage in putting together a successful season. The Colorado Buffaloes have never released a player in the first overall pick in the NFL draft, but they have released a second overall pick. Which brings us to this week's trivia question. When was the last time a Colorado player was drafted second overall in the NFL draft?
All right, well, I'm excited to hear about that trivia question.
I am too. I'm actually not sure what the answer is going to be. But also coming up, we have some club tennis for you. You can see it right there. Now it's in forward. So stay tuned.
Hey, how's it going? Yeah, how was your weekend? Oh, have you studied for
Josh? Oh, yeah. Matters.
CU Sports Mag's John Michael Tomczak went to the CU tennis courts to see how CU's co-ed club tennis team is preparing for nationals.
Below Boulder's majestic Flatirons, CU's lesser-known tennis team practices their game for an upcoming trip to nationals this weekend in Surprise, Arizona. CU's club tennis team will send four men and four women to nationals as they try to serve CU with their first ever national championship.
During the season, the team consists of 15 men and 15 women with no formal head coach. We caught up with members of the team during practice here at the CU Boulder South tennis facility.
We've just always been student run, so it hasn't been that bad. Kind of the president and the vice president kind of take control and kind of serve as like captains of the team. So it's not that hard. As far as practices go, it's pretty much everyone has played competitive tennis enough to know what to do at practice.
Even without a coach, the club tennis team's A and B squad placed first and second at regionals in Salt Lake City, which qualified them for nationals. They'll need that kind of performance to win in Arizona.
What do you believe you're going to bring to the table come nationals this weekend?
Well, I don't know. I hope to volley well, hope to serve pretty well, and I don't know how good serve returns. You know, I've learned that there are a ton of good players out there. I didn't expect so many highly trained players out here.
Club president Heather Sabatica, who could not be here, stated that she wants to see them fight for matches and says CU fans should watch out for a breakout performance by Blair Rehnquist on the girls' side.
Even while overcoming significant odds, as one of CU's most successful club teams, the CU club tennis team maintains their poise and perspective as they chase towards their dream of winning a national championship. For CU Sports Mag, John Michael Tomczak.
The tennis team was shut out 7-0 by the Baylor Bears, who are still undefeated in the Big 12 last Sunday. The loss brings the Buffs to a 500 season at 10-10 overall and 3-6 within the conference. Even tennis phenomenon Monica Maluski suffered a loss to the nation's fifth-best player, Lenka Brzuva, 6-3, 6-2. The end of the season is quickly approaching, and the Buffs are hoping to turn the luck around and extend their winning streak at home this weekend. Wrapping up its home schedule this weekend, Colorado will take on Texas A&M Friday and Texas on Sunday. This weekend will mark the last time seniors Melissa Esposito and Monica Waluski will suit up for CU. Standout Camilla Balassi and another senior will be at the match, but on the sidelines nursing a torn ACL. CU enters the weekend winners of three of their last five matches, but the Buffs have struggled versus the Aggies of late. The last time CU recorded a victory versus Texas A&M was 1998. But things will only get tougher come Sunday match versus the Longhorns. Texas, ranked number 19 nationally, enters Sunday's matchup having won six straight and are currently second in the Big 12. Sunday's match will begin at 11 a.m. on the South Campus courts.
Men's golf was in College Station, Texas this Sunday, competing in the Texas A&M Aggie Invitational. After the second round, number 90 Colorado was 11th and moved to 9th at one point before finishing in 11th place at 30 over par. The number 6 Aggies were the big winners at 38 under par and finishing 21 strokes of number 1 Oklahoma State. This was the last tournament before the Buffs head to the 14th annual Big 12 Championships Friday in Colorado.
Everyone at CU loves our mascot, Ralphie, but how much do they really know about our beloved buffalo? Our woman on the street, Stacy Sams, went to find out.
Thanks, guys. I'm Stacy Sams, reporting on Man on the Street for this week. The University of Colorado has had the buffalo as their mascot for many decades. Today, I'm here to find out how much CU students really know about their own mascot. How many Ralphies have the CU Buffaloes had in the mascot family?
Eight?
Three? I think it's five.
What is her actual name right now?
Precious.
I have no idea.
I have no idea.
Answer is Blackout.
Blackout. Appropriate.
How many pounds do you think that Ralphie 5 or Blackout weighs?
432.
2,000.
450?
That's correct. How long has Ralphie 5 been with us?
A year.
Yeah. 10 years?
7 years.
Since 2007. What does Ralphie do at the football games?
I think Ralphie runs around with people.
He runs around before the football starts?
Runs around the field? Chills in her little pen.
It turns out that many students do have a soft spot for our 450-pound mascot. I'm Stacy Sams, reporting for CU Sports Mag.
Thanks, Stacy. And we've had a pretty crazy week of weather, and I'm really looking forward to that weekend forecast we have coming up after the break.
And we also have a special tribute to our executive producer, Russell Cunningham, coming up. CU's Jeremy Dotson took care of business last Saturday at the Michael Johnson Invite. The senior sprinter won the 100-meter dash with a time of 10.55 seconds. He beat out Baylor Whitney Prevost by 0.03 of a second. Dotson was set to run the 200-meter dash later that day, but the event was canceled due to lightning and rain. CU's track team will attend three meets this weekend, CSU's Glenn Morris combined event, and the Jack Christensen Invite, as well as Cal Berkeley's Brutus Hamilton Invite.
All right, Buff fans, we know you have been dying to hear the answers to that trivia question, but first, a reminder of what we asked. When was the last time a Colorado player was drafted second overall in the NFL draft? And the answer is running back Bo Matthews, who was drafted by the San Diego Chargers in 1974. Matthews had a short but sweet six-year NFL career playing for the San Diego Chargers, New York Giants, and Miami Dolphins. All right, well, I really want to know what that weather is.
Oh, I know. Luke Rosenmeyer has us for it coming up.
Thanks, guys, and welcome to the last edition of Sports Mag Weather for the semester. It's been kind of an up and down week this week in terms of weather. We've had some sun and some rain, and if you've been outside recently, you know that it's really nasty. So let's take a look at that national map to see how Colorado's doing. As you can see, we've got those blues going on in Colorado. That means it's pretty cold, 30s and 40s. However, as we near the end of April, we start to see it warm up a little bit. You see down in the southwest, you've got temperatures getting up into the 60s and 70s. As for Boulder, it's not looking too good for the weekend. It's going to be icky. We've got temperatures in the 40s and 50s. However, it's going to be rain and some sleet on Friday and Saturday. On Sunday, it should clear up a little bit, high of almost 60. But then on Monday, we'll be back to where we were with the rain. However, by the end of next week, we should be back to Colorado sunny skies once again. As for CU Athletics, as the year winds down, there's not a whole lot going on, but the women's golf team is in Norman, Oklahoma, trying to bring home a trophy at the Big 12 Championships. They'll be doing that in some great weather, high of 73, low of 53, under sunny skies. Hopefully they can bring home some hardware for the Buffs. As for pro athletics, there's not too much going on in Denver either. However, the Jazz are playing host to the Nuggets in Salt Lake City. That's game three. The Nuggets will look to take a 2-1 series lead. That's tip-off is at 8:30 Mountain Time tomorrow night. High of 75, low of 68 under some nice clear skies in Utah. And if you're a ski bum, you're almost out of options. Breckenridge, Keystone, and Vail are all closed. However, Arapahoe Basin is still open. They'll be getting some snow on Friday and Saturday, temperatures in the 30s and 40s, but Sunday is going to be the best day if you're looking to go skiing. They'll have a couple fresh inches of snow from the 2 days of snow on Friday and Saturday, and then they'll have some sunshine coming out on Sunday. So I recommend going skiing on Sunday, maybe catching some movies this weekend since it won't be too nice outside. But that's all the time we've got for Sports Mag Weather. Just wear a jacket if you go outside, and we'll kick it back to the desk.
Thank you, Luke. Up next, we have a special tribute.
That's right, to our executive producer, Russell Cunningham, who is graduating. Let's see it.
Hi, and welcome to Sports Mag. I'm Luke Rosenmeyer, sitting alongside Russell Cunningham.
Yeah, nice to see you today, Luke. So, the University of Colorado football team took on the Kansas State Wildcats, and we got some highlights to show you guys. Roll it!
Russell, just like Brandon Marshall, you're not going to be around in the fall, and we're definitely going to miss you.
I'm especially going to miss after every show when Steve makes fun of you.
Hey there, Raisin Cakes. I just wanted to thank you for all the stuff you've done for me over the past 2 years, and I know you're going to go real far.
I'll never forget how you reduce our tension before a show by eating it on the floor, but then still continuing to give us directions. I know you're going to do really great, and we're going to miss you a lot.
Russell
is
awesome. I know someday, Russell, that you're going to be directing Rockies games or some kind of baseball games, and maybe taking Jim Armentrout's job with FSM.
The coaches Nebraska has ever had in the history of Nebraska. And Nebraska's had a pretty storied history, right? I mean, yeah. They used to be good at one point in time. I don't know what happened.
We're really going to miss all of your, you know, optimistic output on life and, you know, your backwards Rockies hat. Have a good one, bro. I know you're going to do well.
You're going to be awesome. Thank you so much, and good luck.
It's great to have you around. You're always someone they can depend on. And, you know, someone that you can go to for any sort of advice.
Also, I think that their defense sucks, straight up.
Thanks for all the help, Russell. Good luck in your future endeavors.
Everything I know now is because of you, and good luck with your future career. Hope you're directing sports soon.
I'm really, really going to miss you, and just know that all my editing skills I pretty much learned from you.
It's been awesome spending time with you at Sports Mag. I've learned so much from you, as I know so many other members of Sports Mag have.
Do their thing for now.
Well, thanks a lot for coming. Well, it looks like let's see here. So, go ahead.
Thanks for all your help. You've really helped me out a lot when I've had a ton of questions about CG.
Good luck graduating and good luck finding a job.
I really appreciate all you've done. Sports Mag was a blast with you. Yeah, just thanks. Thanks for everything.
You've helped me learn a lot, and I thank you a lot for that, and good luck.
Thanks for everything that you've done to help me advance in my journalism career.
Hey, Ross, I remember walking up to the Sports Mag booth as a scared little freshman seeing you and Amanda there, and I briefly considered not coming at all when I found out that you were part of Sports Mag.
By far the best director that I've ever seen, and I think anybody should probably model themselves after you.
Thanks, Heather. So this week, Daryl Scott officially said that he no longer wants to play for the University of Colorado. He sent a text message to the coach, Darren Hagan, the running backs coach, and said that he no longer wanted to play and he wanted out of Colorado. When Hagan got this text message, he moved it on to Hawkins. Hawkins, instead of calling Scott into his office, sent him a text asking what's going on. And what he said was, "Coach, I'm out." And that's all that happened. So Daryl Scott no longer wants to play for the University of Colorado.
The new open we have that you made, I'm of course going to remember you every time we watch it. It's an amazing open.
There's one thing to remember about him is he's the hardest worker that you will ever know.
He was really, really easygoing and really, just really good at teaching.
Pulling a show together at midnight hours, the best times I've had here, really.
I don't know who is going to replace your goofiness, and more importantly, who's going to replace all of the flack you get from Steve Jones.
You don't want to take eligibility away from Cody Hawkins. He's one of the top-ranked quarterbacks coming out of high school, and you really want to use him as much as possible.
And you really want to use him as much as possible.
And you really want to use him as much as possible.
3 years ago, I thought you were a senior, so it's taken a long time for it to get to this day.
For the year that I've been around working with you, it's been a pleasure. I've learned a lot from you.
Russell, when you're gone, I don't know who I'm going to argue about sports with, especially baseball, who's better, the Rockies or the Twins, so we'll have to continue that argument when you come back.
You've stepped your game up, you've motivated me to step my game up, so I just want to thank you, and I look forward to working with you in the future, as I know we will. And to all you other Sports Maggers, I'm in charge now, so watch out.
That's all the time we have for Sports Mag this week. Yeah, thanks a lot for stopping by, and you know. Run, you can run. Tell my friend Bobby. Oh, wow. Well, thanks so much. That's a really cool package. I really appreciate that from everyone. You know, it's pretty cool to be able to do Sports Mag for this long period. I've been thinking about what to say, and I really have no idea. So thanks, everyone here. You guys are awesome. I don't know what I would be doing without you. And thanks to everyone else. I know Steve Jones couldn't be here today, but I want to thank him. And Sports Mag next semester will be pretty cool. So hopefully everything goes well, and I'll see you guys later.
All right, that's all the time we have for CU Sports Mag this week. Russell Cunningham, Sam Holt, and Kylie Burst, and the rest of CU Sports Mag. See you next year.